will be sung after the anthem.
Glory to God in the highest. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Whether Jews or Greeks, slaves or free persons. and we were all given to drink of one spirit. Now the body is not a single part, but many. You are Christ's body, and individually parts of it. The word of the Lord.
So to anoint someone is to set them up according to power. So whether it's a baptism or whether it's a king or a queen, and we all share in that royal dignity with our Lord. Now also seemingly crazy is the fact that we're told of our Jewish forebears who are coming out of the Babylonian exile. Nehemiah is one of the minor prophets of the Old Testament. The book of Nehemiah only comprises about 10 chapters, so when you thumb through the Old Testament, it's very easy to miss. Now, why are all the people getting giddy and happy? They seem to be throwing a party. What's going on here? Now, the Babylonian exile happened around the year 590 to 540 BC. And when you look at the Old Testament, there are all these exiles that happen either because of the ravaging of the pagan nations that surround them, And then many times God actually lets them be invaded because they're not being obedient to his commandments. So they weren't allowed to practice their faith. The Sabbath did not exist. So the scene that we have going on here is that as soon as they reach the city of Jerusalem, Ezra the priest begins to read from the Torah, and the people listen attentively. And then the response is, amen, amen. They bow themselves down before the presence of the Lord with their faces down on the ground. Now, it's not like what we usually experience, you know, during Mass, word of the Lord, amen. Why is Father preaching so long? Oh, I can't wait to get out of here so that I can get, you know, the rest of my day going. You know, it's very easy to get into that complacency, right? So that's why we see this very joyful and concerted effort to rejoice in the Lord, because for about 60 years or so, the people could not practice their faith. They were not even familiar with the law of God. Now, when we continue reading in Nehemiah, there are two main effects from the people getting their homeland back. The first is that they reform the celebration of the Sabbath. They're really emphasizing it as a day of rest. But then they also get serious about marriage, as it was true in the ancient world, and it's actually probably worse. In our own time, marriage was kind of all over the place. Marriage could be whatever you wanted it to be. If you wanted to get a divorce, hey, that's also, you know, cool. So these are the two main effects of the people getting their homeland and then getting the law. So let's break these down a bit. The Sabbath. We know that the first three commandments that God gives us all have to deal with God, and the last seven deal with our interactions with our neighbor. So God commanded us to honor and to celebrate the Sabbath. He knows that we need it. It is to be a day of rest. Now, the average American is addicted to work. We have a very neurotic attitude to this. So after Mass, you know, I ask kids, you know, what are you doing for the rest of the day? Father, I'm doing my homework. No, you're not. Sunday's a day of rest. That's what Friday and Saturday's for. And then they look at me like I've got worms like crawling out of my head. Or if it's an adult, I'm going to the store, I'm grocery shopping, I'm doing laundry, I'm doing this, I'm like, no, it's the Sabbath. We're not to do unnecessary work. I think a lot of people are actually confused because we don't know how to tell the difference between work that recreates us, but then servile work. So I don't know, I mean, are there people here who enjoy doing laundry? I mean, I certainly don't. But the point and idea is that not only does the human body need rest, but the human soul and the human spirit needs rest. So hopefully you have hobbies. Some people are into sports, some people are into music, some people are into gardening. You know, these things recreate and sustain the human person. And it's a necessity. During the French Revolution, when they banned the practice of the Catholic faith, they actually went to a 10-day work week. So rather than a 7-day week, they went to a 10-day work week. And they found after just a couple of months, the horses were dying, the crops were failing, people were getting all crazy. You know, that only lasted for a very short span of time. So my sense is we're in bad need of recovering the Sabbath, because not only from a faith point of view, but also from a human existence point of view, we don't want to let go of this neuroticism and this addiction to work. When I've counseled people who are battling any form of substance abuse, you know, whether it's the bottle or other kinds of drugs, the people will put it that I gave up everything for that one drug. And the path of recovery consists of letting that one thing go for everything that we see in the book of Nehemiah is that they get serious about respecting the institution of marriage. Now, as a priest, I'm blessed to do marriage prep, and it's something that I enjoy. But one of the things I've noticed is whether it's the church or couples who are not married, we tend to emphasize compatibility. So at a lot of parishes, we make couples, I personally don't do this, but I know a lot of parishes do. They have prepared enriched tests, and it's 100 multiple choice tests, and it tells you a lot about the individual, whether the bride or the groom, and then it spits back a bunch of results about the couple. And a lot of couples who do this find that it usually brings up one or two topics that they might have not talked about, like finances or family of origin issues or expectations about family and house and all that kind of stuff. And that's a good kind of thing. But what I tend to really hit home is that we're making you ready to love in the future. I already know you're in love. That's the obvious thing. But what we're getting you ready for is to make a decision to love. And it's very normal for a lot of couples. It's usually somewhere around 3 to 10 years of marriage where you kind of have that crisis of love. Sometimes you get stuck in that complacency. So whether it's communication or intimacy or those sorts of things, it's a really gut-wrenching decision to keep going in that. Now, I can't tell you how many times I get a call from one of the fiancés, Father, we're getting married, can we set up an appointment, can we get married? So I have the couple in my office and we fill out the marriage application, and there's one side for the bride and there's one side for the groom, and then I can feel the nervousness. They are shacking up, and they know they're not supposed to be shacking up, so I look at the groom, and I'm like, okay, what's your address? Right, okay, what's your address? And it's the same one. They're, like, waiting for me to, like, turn red and to, like, persecute them or something. All right, now, I know they're nervous, and the last thing they need is for me to put out the fire with gasoline. Now, when I, ask them a little bit about themselves, where are they from, and what kind of work do they do, and then I ask them, well, what do you do to hang out and ship? Now, about a third to a half of my couples, this is something I started picking up on about 5 years ago. When I ask couples that question, they're kind of like, what do you mean, what do we do to hang out? Like, okay, like some couples work out, some couples go to the movie, couples are different. But what I'm finding, and what I found to be the case, is that they're not spending time to be emotionally bonded and to talk about everything that between the earth and the stars. They're married to their work. So some couples, I gotta spend a lot of time with this, like, go out, have a date night, watch a movie, because I think that once couples get engaged, they get stuck on like autopilot. And it's like, I'm not here to tell you what you have to do, but the point is spend time. Spend time alone with each other. Spend time with each other's family. Talk about all of these things. My dad proposed to my mom after 2 weeks of dating. And I told my dad, I said, Dad, that was kind of gutsy. And he basically said, when you know, and the rest is history. What I'm seeing is that couples are engaged for like an exorbitant amount of time, like 5 years. They're running themselves ragged, spending tens of thousands of dollars on a reception, and they're literally running themselves ragged. And I find that with the Sabbath, but also the rest that the human person needs in terms of a marriage, honesty is always the best policy. So I tend to not hide anything, in this particular case, marriage prep.
I mean, when couples see that, you know, kind of like the walls, like, come down. Because, I mean, it's not my job to torture the couple. It's my job to help them make that decision. You know, the way the church puts it, I'm not the one marrying them. I'm simply the official witness. The couple, the man and the woman, those are the official ministers of the sacrament. So it's very important that either as a Christian, but also as a spouse, we give ourselves the time. That's really the most important thing. Everything really follows from that. Now, you and I are probably not going to go through that exile that our brothers and sisters went through 2,600 years ago. It does still happen in certain parts of the world, in certain countries in Africa, in certain parts of Asia. Some people are pushed from their home, they're persecuted. And these things still happen in our midst. But while we may not have to deal with this physical exile, most of us deal with that spiritual and moral and emotional exile, the one between the head and the heart, but also the one between the body and the soul. Ours is an age, we tolerate everything, okay, who am I to judge, and I can't say anything about this or that, but if you commit certain sins on social media or in the workplace, you are going to be exiled and pushed out, and everything is unforgivable. That's the paradox of our own day, where we, on the outside, we push the tolerance kind of thing, but there's this unwritten code where if you break a certain rule, you're going to be cast out, you're going to be pushed out. So this world ain't it. We are ultimately called to heaven. And hopefully we're taking seriously this path, this journey of our faith. And, you know, we should never say to ourselves that the people who heard the words of our Lord in the synagogue are somehow better than us because they witnessed it. Keep this in mind. The same people who heard the preaching of our Lord, the same people who were witness to his exorcisms and his healing, were the same people who called for the crucifixion of our Lord. So the Lord's speaking to us today. And when we read the readings, it's not like some remembering of past events. No, it's the Lord speaking to us right now. And we need to listen and listen louder. We need to be good receivers so that we have this strength for this journey. Dear friends, we stand and with one voice we now profess the faith of the Lord. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, consubstantial with the Father. we now present to our Heavenly Father, the prayers we hold for our church, our nation, and
that those anointed to lead the church may be prophets of truth and justice. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the word of God in scripture and tradition may be spirit and life for people today. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That captives of drug or alcohol addictions may find freedom. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That as many parts of one body, we may work for the poor and marginalized in our community. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the sick, especially for Elizabeth Barakal, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who have died, especially for Elaine Anzac, Arthur Jesu, and Marcelina Melke, and for their family and friends who mourn them, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And for Dolores Lozen, for whom this Mass is offered, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We ask our merciful God to listen kindly to our petitions and to those of the entire church. Now let us pray together Psalm 23.
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. In green pastures he gives me repose. Beside us the waters he leads me. He refreshes my soul. He guides me in right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk in the dark valley, I fear no evil. For you are at my side. With your rod and your staff, you spread the table before me in the sight of my foes. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Only goodness and kindness follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord for years to come.
Please join us in our offertory song, number 672, Good News, number 672.
Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ
by which he has freed us from the yoke of sin and death, summoning us to the glory of being now called God's chosen race, all royal priesthood, all holy nation, possible for your own possession. You proclaim everywhere your mighty works, for you have called us out of darkness into your own wonderful light. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory as without end we acclaim. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. Long history of faith. May he make of us an eternal offering to you so that we may obtain an inheritance of your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for and fairly now. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity our pilgrim church on earth with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Alan Vigner, our bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your home. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children spread throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen.
Let the Savior's commandment flow by divine spirit we be here to stay.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Grant, we pray, Almighty God, that receiving the grace by which you bring us to new life, we may always glory in your gift through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with
may Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Please join us in our closing song, number 495, Chanticle of the Sun, number 495.